Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's ATSE seminar. My name's Carolyn McVean and I'm the Parliamentary Librarian. Before we start, I just wish to say on behalf of the Parliament of Victoria and its members, we acknowledge the traditional owners on the land in which we are meeting. We pay our respects to them, their culture, their elders past, present and future, and elders from other communities who may be with us today. Our moderator today is Dr. Margaret Hartley, who is an independent director on the board of Wintermute Biomedical. Please welcome Margaret.
Thank you very much, Carolyn. It's certainly a great pleasure to be here and to be meeting face-to-face after a couple of years now of webinars. And as you know, Sandra Kentish is unable to be with us today, but we still have very terrific speakers. Sandra's home in quarantine, having got COVID just this week, so it's never ending. Well, we're here to talk about the challenges and issues related to carbon sequestration, which is the capture and often the use and the storage of carbon. And the approaches to this, including engineering technology in industrial settings and the more natural approaches in the agricultural sector. So we'll hear why we need to draw down carbon as part of actions to achieve net zero carbon by 2050, and about soil carbon in the broader context of productive and sustainable agriculture. Our first speaker is going to be Dr. Mark Toner, who has kindly agreed to replace Sandra, which is very good. And thank you, Mark, for doing that on short notice. He's going to talk about industrial approaches to carbon capture and storage. Mark is a fellow of the Academy and a former chief executive of the Australian subsidiary of a major international engineering construction group, Kavanagh, ENC, which is now known as Worley. He oversaw operations in the resources industry, including mining and metals, oil and gas, chemicals, pulp and paper. Mark's had numerous leadership positions, including as the past chair of Australian Science Innovations, a chair of CalSmelt, and director of the Trans-Tasman Commercialisation Fund. And he's been on the board of Engineers Australia's Centre for Engineering Leadership and Management. He was the president of the Business and Higher Education Roundtable and chairman of the Institute of Chemical Engineers in Australia. He's currently the principal in Gender Matters, an Australian management consultancy which advises businesses and universities on gender and unconscious bias issues in the workplace. And our second speaker will be Richard Eckard, who's the Professor of Sustainable Agriculture in the University of Melbourne and Director of the Primary Industries Climate Challenges Centre. Richard's a world authority on sustainable agricultural production with a focus on carbon neutral practices and adaptation to climate change. He developed the first greenhouse gas accounting tools and provided the science basis for development of 6 carbon offset methods for Australian agriculture. So it's my great pleasure to hand over to Mark, who then will be followed by Richard. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you very much, Margaret, and I'm delighted to be here to talk about engineered solutions to carbon sequestration. So let me just show you this slide in particular. We all know the Victorian government has legislated for net zero emissions of greenhouse gases by 2050, and a commitment also made by the Australian government. And just as a reminder for you with science or non-science backgrounds, the major greenhouse gases are carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, and various fluorocarbons. They're the damaging chemicals in our atmosphere. Wouldn't it be great if we could just pull carbon dioxide, CO2, out of the atmosphere directly and store it away somewhere? That's called carbon capture, direct air capture. But the trouble is that CO2 in air, as you know, is only very, very low concentrations. We actually want it to be lower than it is, but it's about 400 parts per million in the atmosphere. And therefore, it's extremely dilute. So if you're trying to process air and take the CO2 out directly, you've got a problem because, you know, there's a lot of air and very little CO2. And once you've captured that CO2, if you can, you'd then need to store it somewhere, stick it away deep underground and store it forever, if possible. So I'd just like to mention that CCS, which is the carbon capture and storage technology, is proven in one application area only, which is oil and gas production. In the 1990s in Norway, it was used very successfully to trap CO2 or to capture CO2 and then store it underground in vast underground reservoirs, kilometres under the surface. But even in that area where it has been proven and used successfully, it's not always easy to use, it doesn't always follow. You can just use it if you're producing oil and gas. And you're probably aware that in offshore WA, the giant Gorgon gas condensate field, Chevron has been unable to meet the requirements of its production licence for technical reasons, and they've been unable to store the many millions of CO2 underground that they set out to achieve in their licence. So CCS, although proven in that area of oil and gas production, can be difficult to operate. So really it has two issues. It can have technical issues and it can have economic cost issues as well, of course. So in Victoria, we may require CCS in the future, and probably will, for one or more of the following and possibly other areas. Hydrogen production from brown coal in Victoria in the Latrobe Valley. I'll come back and talk a bit more about this project in particular, the Hydrogen Energy Supply Chain Project. The second area is cement production. The problem with cement, which we need for concrete, is that it generates CO2 in the process itself, as well as requiring a lot of energy by burning fuels to actually make the process work. And in cement production, where you turn limestone, calcium carbonate, into lime, which is calcium oxide, you produce about one unit of CO2 for every unit of cement. And the problem the cement industry gives us is that about 8% of global CO2 emissions are generated by the cement industry around the world. 8% of CO2 emissions is cement. And you know how much concrete we use everywhere, you know, therefore we will continue to need cement. So that's a real problem, I think, for all of us, how to get CCS to be used in the cement industry, which hasn't happened yet. And natural gas purification, so when you generate, when you produce gas or liquids out of a field, like in Bass Strait, then you often have CO2 in that gas and it's got to be removed so that the natural gas can meet a sales specification so it can be piped into Melbourne and other parts of Victoria. And so ExxonMobil at its Longford gas plant in Gippsland, if it has CO2 in future, it will probably have to use CO2. At the moment, if there's CO2, they vent it, release it to the atmosphere, and we just can't afford to keep doing that, obviously, if we want to meet net zero by 2050. And the other two projects I'll come back to talk about briefly are the Otway International Test Centre, you may be aware of, near Port Campbell. They're testing CCS, and I'll show you a picture of that. And the last one is the Carbon Net Project in the Latrobe Valley. I'll just show you a picture of that as well. But before I do that, let's just look at direct air capture, because it sounds so great. There's a pilot project in Iceland using geothermal energy, which is a nice energy to use. You don't have to pay much for it. But as I said, CO2 being 400 ppm, maybe 420 ppm at the moment, in our atmosphere, means that it's just always going to be an expensive process, even though it's quite elegant. So they, using large fans, they draw ambient air through these, they call them filters, but they're really solid materials that adsorb the CO2 onto their surface. And when those materials are loaded up with CO2, then you strip the CO2 off. And in that project, they're then putting CO2 into water and pumping a CO2 water solution underground. The problem is, as I said, the cost is huge. And if you look at this diagram, this is from the International Energy Agency. The light blue lines are low concentration of CO2, and I'll explain that in a minute. So look at the top line. The numbers along the top, by the way, are US dollars a tonne for capturing CO2, not for storing, just for capturing it, right, to getting it from whatever material you're trying to extract it from. So that line, direct air capture, just shows the costs are incredibly high. Maybe one day it'll become more economic. Solar panels were very expensive, you know, when they started, and they've become cheaper over the years. So maybe direct air capture will get used somewhere, but at the moment it's I would say it's not possible to see it being commercial for quite a while. So the other places where CO2 is low, and because when you've got low CO2 concentrations, it's going to be expensive to extract it, to capture it. So in a power generation system, coal or gas-fired power generation, the CO2 in the flue gas is about 10 to 15% only because they're burning coal or gas in air. Most of the gas in the flue gas is nitrogen, which is in our air at 78%. So the problem there is you've got this low concentration of CO2 and you've got to process all that flue gas just to get this relatively small amount of CO2 out. And therefore it's expensive when it's low concentration, as is the case with cement and iron and steel production. I'm not expecting you to remember all these numbers, obviously, but the point of this graph really is to show that when you've got high concentrations of CO2 in the stream you are processing, the costs are going to be a lot less because you're dealing with much lower volumes that you have to put through your processing plant. So this project called the Hydrogen Energy Supply Chain Project in the Latrobe Valley. So it's a pilot scale project. It has Japanese and government investment in it. They're gasifying Victorian brown coal and a biomass mix to produce hydrogen. They've successfully made enough hydrogen to liquefy it, put it on a ship and send it off to Kobe in Japan. It was the first, I believe, I think the press said that was the first time that had been achieved, liquid hydrogen, which is at minus 253 degrees Celsius, minus 253 degrees to liquefy hydrogen, extremely low temperature, therefore a large amount of energy needed just to get down to that temperature and then to store it at that temperature. So liquid hydrogen looks like uneconomic just from a point of view of keeping it so cold, but they did demonstrate they can export it as liquid hydrogen. When do you make hydrogen from gasification of gas or coal, natural gas or coal? It's called brown hydrogen, but if you then use CCS as well in the process, it's called blue hydrogen. So I should point out that hydrogen is a colourless gas, right? It doesn't have these colours. These colours are used to give you the source of the hydrogen. So it's called brown hydrogen if it's coming from a gasification process where you make syngas, which is CO, carbon monoxide and hydrogen. If you use CCS, as I say here in the second paragraph, it's called blue hydrogen. And the problem with gasification processes is that it produces a huge amount of CO2. One kilogram of brown H2O, which is happening in the Latrobe Valley in this project, produces 15 kilograms of CO2, right? A large amount of CO2 for each unit of hydrogen. So the other common colours you might hear about are, as I said, blue is hydrogen produced from fossil fuels, gas, petroleum, coal. And if it comes from renewable energy through electrolysis, it's called green. Those production costs there, $2 a kilogram versus $5 a kilogram, are very rough. At the moment, about 2% of the hydrogen in the world is green, and about 98% is blue. And the green component, obviously, in relative terms will increase as well as in absolute terms. As time goes on, we will make more green hydrogen from electrolysis using renewable energy. But that's where we are at the moment. So this is a pilot project. It doesn't use CCS yet, but if it goes into the commercial phase, then it will need to use some form of CCS to store away the CO2. The next project that I mentioned is the Otway Test Site, which is beyond Port Campbell, past Cape Otway. The vertical line on the left, that blue and red line, is a production well. They're producing carbon, it's a bit hard to read probably, but methane and carbon dioxide is occurring naturally in a reservoir almost 2 kilometres below ground. That's under pressure, natural pressure, so it comes up to the surface, they treat it and compress it, and then they put it down this injection well and store it again in roughly the same reservoir. And this is all about learning more about CCS in Victoria, how it can be made to work. This project's been running for 18 years and they have drilled 7 injection wells and they have so far stored 95,000 tonnes of CO2, which is quite a lot. So it's an impressive project. This well on the right, this white one, is a monitoring well, so they can actually see where the CO2 is going when it's down in that level of that formation down deep down. So again, that's a project that is, I think, really interesting, and I think they need to be commended for the work they've done in order to obviously get the data and work out some of the costs for this type of CCS. And the last project I'll mention is Carbon Net, again, I believe, funded by others, including the Victorian government. And the idea here is that any CO2 produced by manufacturers in the Latrobe Valley can put their CO2 into a pipeline. That CO2 could come from ExxonMobil's gas plant at Longford, the Maryvale pulp mill, or the hydrogen project we talked about in the Latrobe Valley. You collect that CO2, compress it, send it to some place where you can store it, in this case, an offshore gas field called Pelican. That's apparently 8 kilometres offshore. And this is the sort of project that I think Victoria is going to need if we are really going to take CCS seriously. But again, there's a lot of work to be done technically as well as commercially. So in conclusion, let me just say that there are projects like this, you know, in other parts of Australia and in the world, which is what we need. But if we are to reach net zero by 2050, we do need many different engineered solutions, and we need projects like these to be developed, tested, and hopefully brought into commercial operation. Thank you.
Good day. Thank you very much for the opportunity to talk to you. I'll talk about biological carbon sequestration and some of the challenges we face there. Mark started off by talking about the targets that have been set by governments. We know the Paris Climate Agreement set the world on a course towards a climate neutral outcome. But what we've seen in agriculture is it's not actually government targets that are driving the show. I point you to this. This is just a beginning point of the number of multinational companies around the world, agricultural supply chain companies that are setting their own targets. I have these surreal meetings with some of these boards where one of them phoned me up and said, can you meet with us? We set a target. We don't know how to get there. Can you work us through how we're going to get there? Which is a bit weird. I point you to the bottom left. The two major banks that hold more than 50% of the agri-debt market in Australia have set their targets. They have to true up to APRA and to the European Central Bank on their emissions liability and their loan portfolio. So this is what's driving agriculture, because if you think about agriculture, 70% of Australian agriculture is exported. So what matters to agriculture is, by 2030, what are the compliance regulations you will have to meet in order to maintain access to that supply chain? That's actually what's critical for the future and why we need to take this seriously. Because these supply chains have set their targets. I found out the other day some of them have actually committed to switching to plant-based protein. I think that's misguided, but, you know, it's there. So we've got to deal with that as well. Now, how does that relate to soil carbon? Well, we were part of the Net Zero Australia plan that looked at how the whole of Australia, what we needed to do to get to net zero. And what that taught us is that agriculture in its own right is going to struggle to meet its own supply chain targets by 2030 through to 2050. So the notion that there's all this surplus carbon credit in agriculture to offset the industrial sector is actually quite fanciful. And so it started changing the language we're using with farmers and supply chain. We will move from an offsetting mindset in agriculture to an insetting mindset. So Climate Active is already starting to work on an insetting framework for agriculture where if it's on your farm, you keep it for your own purposes first and foremost, because that's actually accessing your supply chain is the most important component. So we know agriculture has certain emissions profiles. Dairy on the left, a large component of that is methane, but also nitrous oxide. In the middle, the chicken meat industry, well, nothing from the birds. It's all from the manure management post the house. So their options are very different. Cropping, for example, very different, again, mainly from nitrogen fertilizer. So we're working on different plans on these different industries that I can talk you through. So because they had these emissions profiles and we don't have a carbon neutral cow, we don't have a methane free cow, we don't have nitrous oxide free fertilizer just yet, we're looking at soil carbon as a way of offsetting or ameliorating that impact. But what we forget in the enthusiasm, there's been a lot of enthusiasm, but there's also a lot of misinformation about soil carbon. And the first law we forget is the law of diminishing returns. If you plant trees, they won't grow forever. 20 years later, those trees will slow down their growth rate. By the time they get to 60 years old, they're not sequestering carbon anymore, but that land's gone. Same with soil carbon. You change your management, as in this graph, it's an experiment that went to 300 years in the UK. It teaches us, you make some gains early on by switching management in agriculture, but eventually the law of diminishing returns kicks in and you level out at new steady state. The blue line is the wake-up call, where if you stop that management intervention, you plow the soil or you stop the irrigation water, you will revert back to where you came from. And unfortunately, a lot of the enthusiasm with carbon aggregators signing up our farmers to offset methods says you can do this in perpetuity, that there's a straight line there which doesn't exist. So I think there's a lot of farmers going to be disappointed. The other wake-up call we had is we did a fairly well-publicised case study on jigsaw farms, Mark Whitten's farm near Hamilton, which some of you would know. And we published that, and it really made quite an impact because it said, there's the methane or the livestock emissions in column one, there's the tree sequestration in column two, and the soils in column three, and the net outcome balance, which said that by 2010, Mark was genuinely carbon neutral on balance. And that allowed him to access a premium wool market in Italy for carbon neutral wool, which was a great outcome. But we always predicted the day of diminishing returns would come where the methane continues, but the carbon levels off, the trees grow up. We should have known that. What we weren't ready for was that we repeated the study in 2022, and he's only 50% of the way to carbon neutrality now. The trees grew up quicker than we thought. And you could see what happened to the trees. They peaked at a certain time, and then their sequestration drops off as the trees mature. So what it taught us is this notion that we can just simply offset our way out of problems is quite fanciful. It's very short-term thinking. And in Mark's case, that's 22% of the farm gone to trees. So you've lost, well, in his case, he didn't do it for carbon sequestration, so he hasn't lost valuable agricultural land. But you could argue that's 23% of land out of production. So let's measure out our enthusiasm. The other study we did, and don't worry about the graph, it's just to prove that we did actually do the work. But we looked at what would happen to soil carbon under future climates. And unfortunately, what we found is if rainfall is going down and temperature is going up, we will struggle to hold the soil carbon we have today, let alone set policy targets that say we're going to rely on soil carbon as part of our future emissions reduction profile. So what this graph said is it's low rainfall at Birchip, high rainfall at Hamilton, different soil types, different starting points of carbon, high starting point, low starting point. Lines above where rainfall is increasing in the future, lines below is what's realistic about what may actually happen in the future based on current predictions. What it taught us is that if you continue a grazing system at Hamilton, you would need to reduce stocking rate by 50% by 2070 to maintain today's carbon stocks, 50% less production, and 70%, 80% less production at Birchip to maintain current soil carbon stocks. So I think it's a bit of a reality check for us that unless we do something about the emissions, agriculture is going to struggle. Just to finish off, I think there's another angle we miss here, and that we talk about soil carbon because that's actually what matters to the fossil fuel industries. And so the whole of agriculture is talking about soil carbon, when actual fact, it's not soil carbon that matters to farmers, it's soil organic matter that matters to farmers. Soil organic matter, half of that is carbon, but what holds nitrogen in the soil is organic matter. What holds water in the soil is organic matter. Soil carbon doesn't hold those properties. And so we've focused our entire system on something that doesn't matter to farmers. The organic matter does. And what our research has shown is that the typical productivity benefit of a high carbon soil is about 10 times the productive benefit back to the farmer of what a soil carbon credit would be, of an ACCU. So why would we focus on soil carbon credits when the productivity benefit that's sitting there is about 10 times in terms of extra grass production, extra crop production? And I point you to some of these productivity benefits of just soil organic matter. So from a strategic point of view, high soil organic matter soils bridge between extreme climate events far better than low carbon soils. They're more healthy, they're more productive, they're more resilient. They have biological roles like, for example, they deliver more nitrogen in the cycle. They have better water holding capacity so you can bridge rainfall events better with soil organic matter. They have chemical buffering roles. All things that soil carbon itself doesn't actually deliver, but soil carbon does. So to sort of sum up, if we want healthy soils in the future, we must focus on soil organic matter, not soil carbon. Soil carbon is what matters to an industry that will never get the carbon credits out of agriculture because agriculture needs them. If we want more trees in the agricultural landscape, what our research is showing is that if you focus on carbon, it's not paying for the loss of agricultural land, but if you focus on land survival, shade and shelter, animal welfare, it has an order of magnitude more profitability back to a farmer, and you don't plant a block at the back of the farm, you plant it on the western boundary where you get the shade and shelter benefit. So it's a different way of approaching it. And then finally, our analysis would suggest that agriculture is going to struggle to achieve these low carbon targets in its own right. So this notion that there's a lot of excess credits in the agricultural sector is actually not true. there is a significant effort. We've got to remember we're not alone in this drive towards a low methane cow. The whole world is doing it. I can point you to projects right across the world aiming for it. So if it doesn't happen by 2030, it's probably not possible. Soil and tree carbon may buy us time, but the Jigsaw Farms example told us it might only buy you a maximum of 10 years and then you've lost that land, and that there are no surplus credits. So thank you.